Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. That was a great introduction. I hope I can keep it on my computer and use it at conferences. And this looks like a fun audience, different from my usual audience. I hope you like the introduction too. I'll go easy on the math and try to make sure you still learn something. The questions were actually posed very nicely in this little movie. What do black holes eat, and how come they became so big so fast right after the Big Bang? And so I actually added a subtitle to this talk, Black Holes in Orbit, which you will see how it's relevant at the end. So I actually literally mean these black holes sit at the edge of the universe. And by the edge of the universe, I think we should first clarify what we mean by that. So I want to show you, these are actual galaxies, which we have discovered over the last 10, 15 years. There's a catalog of about a billion of them, and you can see how far we go. So these are distances from us, a slice in the sky. These most distant galaxies live, the light left them when the universe was only about less than a billion years old. Now it's 13.7 billion years old. So they're practically 93% back to the Big Bang. So we're also looking back in time. And now, I want to actually start with a very easy thing, because I know there are experts in the audience, so I want to know if anybody in this room knows who invented the word black hole, because this is something I learned myself quite recently. So I want you to raise your hand. Experts are actually allowed to participate. Do you know who invented the word black hole? It's important because it's one of the most commonly recognized scientific terms, actually, black hole. It's the same in all languages, as far as I know, pretty much transliterated. And so I want to explain how this happened. Okay, John Wheeler, very good. That's the semi-wrong answer. So this is where I work, Columbia University. This is in New York, in the Upper West Side. This is the view from my office. This is the library, and Broadway is here. And when I walk to work, I pass this restaurant on 112th Street. So do you recognize this place? Yes? Okay, so you've seen this, right? This is Tom's Diner, and it's located on 112th Street and Broadway. And in fact, this building, these windows here, is the Goddard Institute for Space Studies. That's a NASA research center. The entrance is here. And this is John Wheeler. He passed away in 2008. And he wrote an autobiography, which I read myself only relatively recently. And this is what he said. In the fall of 1967, Vittoria Canuto, the head of NASA Goddard Institute in Broadway, invited me to a conference. And at this conference, he said, we should consider the possibility that at the center of a pulsar is a neutron star which rotates, and it doesn't really matter here, is a gravitationally completely collapsed object. I remarked that one couldn't keep saying gravitationally completely collapsed object over and over. One needed a shorter phrase. How about black hole, asked somebody in the audience. I had been searching for the term for months, mulling it over in bed, bathtub, wherever I had quiet moments. Suddenly, this name seemed right. So that's quite amazing. I think it's an anonymous person. I tried to find out who it was. I couldn't. Nobody remembers. So when you think of black holes, most of you probably have this image in mind. It's a very heavy, very small thing, which collapsed on itself, which bends space-time a lot. So this little cartoon here is, I think, what most people think of if they think of black holes. The bending of space-time, because they're so heavy. And this, in fact, this is how physicists kind of think of black holes. This is the physicist's picture of a black hole. Gravity pulls an arbitrarily large mass to an arbitrarily small region and bends space-time a lot. And this is actually a solution to the equations which Einstein came up with to how gravity works. It was solved. The equations were solved in 1915 by Karl Schwarzschild, who was incidentally actually in World War I in the trenches while solving this equation on the Russian front. So until the 70s, until the anonymous person came along, sometimes this was called the Schwarzschild's throat. And the black holes have a horizon, which I'm sure you've heard, which for the sun, if the sun collapsed to a black hole, would be 3 kilometers, from which if you go closer to the black hole than 3 kilometers, if it was the mass of the sun, light cannot escape, because the escape velocity is bigger than the speed of light. So physicists like to, I know there's at least two string theorists in this room, and real theoretical physicists like to ask questions about what happens at the singularity, where the density is infinite. What happens at this horizon? Does information really go out of our sight and hidden forever? That's what Stephen Hawking likes to talk about. And is general relativity even the correct extension of Newton's theory? And then physicists, I think, also sometimes ponder whether they actually exist in nature. Even if it's a nice solution, does nature produce these? So I went through this because I want to contrast this with how an astrophysicist like me think of black holes. It's a very, very different picture. We think of them as very lively objects and not very exotic, actually. They're very common. And most importantly, they're not sitting in a vacuum bending space-time. They're surrounded by stuff because they live in galaxies, and galaxies have stars and plasma, and the black hole is surrounded by this. And in fact, there's the typical situation is that matter is swirling around the black hole, trying to fall in, but it has angular momentum, meaning it cannot radially just fall in. It tries to swirl in. And in that process, the matter collides itself and heats up and becomes very bright. This will be important in 10 minutes when we discover why we see these objects at the very, very distant universe. So as I said, in astrophysics, we think of black holes as kind of part of our daily lives. Half the astrophysicists have something that they're working on related to black holes. And we actually know very well that when a star dies and exhausts all its nuclear fuel, it cannot prevent the collapse to a black hole if the star was more massive than about 25 times the mass of the sun. So we know there are such massive stars in our own galaxy. Then they exhaust their fuel, they make small black holes. So we actually know how small black holes are produced in the universe. This is pretty well understood. Many such examples of stellar mass black holes are actually known in our galaxy. Now, there's another example, which is very securely known. There's a 4 million solar mass black hole in our galaxy. Our galaxy, of course, is the Milky Way. And this is 4 million times as heavy as the sun. And just to orient you, this is a picture of how our galaxy looks like. This is the center of our galaxy. This is actually a picture. Of course, we can't take a picture of our own galaxy, but it looks like this. This is Andromeda, our neighbor. This is about 60,000 light years across, and we are sitting here about two-thirds of the way out from the center, on Earth, moving around the sun. And here is this 4 million solar mass black hole. I want everybody in this room to understand how we know that this black hole is there, because we're going to talk about the similar ones much more, much farther away. So the way we know this is we look at stars in the center of the galaxy, which are very, very, very close to the center. So this movie here is actually produced by a group at University of California. And these are actual stars. They look like little blobs. That's just how they're beautified for visualization. But they're actually point sources. They're stars. There's about 10 of them here. And you can see that this movie went from 1998 to 2013.7. That's something like August of 2013. And these stars, I don't know if you can play it again, they move around on orbits which center on this point. We don't see what's there, but we see these stars moving around. Now, just to pay homage to these observational astronomers who measured this, there's a bar here which shows the angular size of this image. So this is 0.05 seconds of arc. I don't know how many people know what is a second of arc. That's an angle on the sky. And 0.05 seconds is roughly the angle you would have for a person who is standing in New York City, viewed from here, from Johannesburg. That's the angle. So this is the region we're looking at. Really, 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 really tiny region of the galaxy.
And yet we see these stars, we can resolve them, they move around, and they move around very fast. So here's my one slide with equations. Just for teaser, this is the last one and there won't be a test, other than where the emergency exits are. So this is the big black hole in the center of the galaxy. This is one of the stars. And as I said, we can actually measure how it's moving. And we also know this distance because we measure the angle in the sky. We know how far away from the center of the galaxy we are located.
So we know this distance and we can measure the motion. And if you've heard of Newton's law of gravity, the force here acting on the star is gm black hole m star over r squared. And then the acceleration is mv star squared over r. So you equate these two, and you find that the black hole mass, the mass of this object, is rv squared over g. R and v squared are things we've measured. So we've basically measured the mass of this black hole by measuring velocities of the stars and the distance from the central point. And this mass that you get is 4 million solar masses. It's so large that nothing that we can even think of exotic things would actually fit in that tiny region. If it's this region here is also, this region you see here is actually roughly the size of the solar system, but there are a million times more mass in there. So it would collapse to a black hole. Now, unfortunately, we can only play this game in one object, our own galaxy, because we're so close to the center. So you can ask, well, what about other galaxies? Do they also have in their centers such a giant black hole? So it turns out we can play a similar game for nearby galaxies. About 100 of them are close enough. So these are two examples of relatively nearby galaxies. They're, again, tens of thousands of light years in size. And they're located maybe out to millions of light years from us. And you can't actually resolve the individual stars. They're way too far. But you can see the cumulative light of the stars in the middle there. And you can still measure the Doppler shift of the light that you see in the center. And you can play the same game applied to the sum total light that you see. And so what we found when we did this, not me, but other people, is that every time you can do this, the galaxy is close enough that you can play this game. You find that in the center, there is a black hole between 1 million and approximately a few billion times the mass of the sun. And so that, as I said, there are about 100 examples known this, but that's all the 100 we can check. So by rational reasoning, you would say if I looked at 100 and there were 100 of them, there's probably all of them have these big black holes. So that's good. In every nearby galaxy, we have these big black holes. Now, what about even further away? So that's a huge leap, because I said we've actually seen galaxies out to a distance which is about 13 billion light years. So when the light left these galaxies, the universe was in its baby infant stage of less than a billion years old. Our deepest image is taken with the Hubble Space Telescope. It's shown here. This, again, is a tiny region of the sky. It's maybe 100 times the one that I showed you from the galactic center. And it's showing a whole bunch of galaxies. So these are very, very far away galaxies. And there's no way we can resolve them and look at their centers and see if there's black holes. However, now we come back to this point that black holes in galaxies, they don't sit in vacuum like theoretical physicists' black holes on paper. They sit in a galaxy. And the galaxy in the middle, there will be stars. And between the stars, there's gas, hydrogen, helium, plasma, which is falling onto this black hole. Now, when it falls into a black hole, it heats up. It becomes extremely hot and radiates. And in fact, somewhat paradoxically, these black holes, rather than being dim black objects, they're actually the brightest things on the sky. So how bright is a black hole? It's good to compare this to the other largest source of energy we know. So if you take a proton and you want to extract energy, then roughly speaking, in a nuclear reactor or in a star which does fusion, you get a mega electron volt. That's a unit of energy. Doesn't matter what it is. It's a million electron volt. That's the binding energy of the nucleus. That's how much energy you gain when you fuse nuclei together in an atomic bomb or a nuclear reactor. Now, when you take this proton and you drop it into the black hole, you get to extract its entire rest mass energy, which Einstein told us is mc squared. That's almost a giga electron volt, about 1,000 times bigger. So the quasar, in principle, this object is called a quasar, is about 200 times brighter than a nuclear reactor and often actually outshines the entire galaxy. In fact, it's not the problem to see the black hole, it's the opposite. When you have these black holes shining so bright, in fact, we don't see the galaxy because it's hidden by the quasar. In fact, that's why the Hubble Space Telescope was originally built, to try to find a smudge galaxy behind these quasars. They're called quasars because they're abbreviation of quasi-stellar objects, because it's a point. It looks like a point, like a star. So originally they thought to be nearby objects, stars. And in fact, they're very distant quasars. And so we see these very, very distant quasars, and they're so bright that we know that has to be a giant black hole, which generates this luminosity. And so there we are in this chart. Not only do we have these massive black holes in our neighborhood in the cosmos, we have them way back, all the way back to the distant galaxies that we can see. So now comes the puzzle, which is basically the point of this talk. How did these black holes, I guess the way it was stated, what do they eat for breakfast? I don't know if breakfast is actually enough. Maybe dinner is better. So how do you make such massive black holes so rapidly? So if you're a very naive person, you can say, well, I either take, we know that stars end up as black holes if they were massive. So we know how to make a 20 solar mass black hole. So naively, you can say, well, I take one of those and I just feed it. We know this gas which is falling on it and providing the large brightness is actually falling to the black hole and increasing the mass. So maybe that can grow it if you do it nicely and if it eats nicely. Or maybe another thing you can think of is you take so many of them that and you just merge the black holes together and you build a bigger black hole. And the trick is we only have about 700 million years to build up to about 1 billion solar masses from a 10, 20 solar mass stellar remnant. So why is this so difficult to do in 1 billion years? That's what I want to impress on you. And then I should actually immediately say the solution to this is not known. We're working on it, me and several other people. So to explain this puzzle, here is the history of the universe. This is here the Big Bang, time equals zero. We are now here at 13.7 billion years. We look with our telescopes back in time, as I explained. The most distant objects we see exist here when the universe is about 1 billion years old. Before then, we don't know what it is. It's the dark ages. And we actually have information about the universe when it was a few hundred thousand years old through the cosmic microwave background radiation. So we know what it looked like then. It had no galaxies. It had basically was a smooth ball of gas with tiny, tiny variations in density, one part in a million or so. And then we think the first stars and galaxies, this is now theory, we can take the fluctuations we see in the density and evolve them forward using theory, and we think that after a few hundred million years, they collapse. These fluctuations in density produce objects which collapse back on themselves and make something you could call a very tiny galaxy. Now, I guess there's no standardized name for these objects. I just call them in this talk protogalactic clouds. They appear a few hundred million years after the Big Bang due to gravitational pull of their own mass, and they collapse. Now, these clouds, the first ones we can know from theory, have about 100,000 solar masses of stuff in them, and they collapse and try to make a galaxy. And now, it's not enough to take a ball of hydrogen, helium, gas, and collapse it. To make a star, you have to collapse it enormously, increase the density from the background universe, which is very, very tenuous, to a star. So here is the problem with this. I just like to talk about this because it's counterintuitive, but so when you take a ball of gas and you compress it, in this case, it's its own gravity that causes it to compress and try to make a star. But if you try to compress some gas with your bicycle pump, for example, you know what happens. Pressure builds up, right? You compress it, density rises, temperature rises, pressure rises, and then you can't collapse anymore. And this also works in the universe. These clouds are collapsing and they're building up pressure, and that's very bad. You can't be 20 orders of magnitude before you would make a star, you would actually not be able to collapse further, and you'd end up with literally clouds of little, I call them little, 10 to the 5 solar masses of cloudlets swimming in the universe. Now, the way to solve this problem, and we know stars form in our galaxy, the way to solve this problem is chemistry, cooling. So here I've shown a picture of a random molecule, and what happens is when you heat up the gas, the molecules collide with one another, and they start shaking and vibrating, and get excited to their electronic, vibrational, rotational states, and then they decay back to their states, the ground state that they like, but then they radiate, emit photons. And this is a process where you continuously deflate the pressure. You take energy from the gas, which is stored in the heat of the collisions, you excite the molecules, and they emit photons, and they radiate. Very good. This allows you to continuously cool the gas, not allow the temperature to rise, and you keep collapsing. This process is pretty well understood, and it very nicely works in our galaxy, because we have a whole bunch of very nice molecules which are very complicated. They shake and vibrate in different ways, and they radiate super efficiently. So I just flash here the periodic table, which we know exists here on Earth and in our galaxy, in the plasma. So the problem with this is that when you go back to the early universe and looking at the very first stars which are forming, I'm sure you, some of you know this, but you know how the periodic table looks like. It looks very boring. There are only two elements practically present in the universe at that time, hydrogen and helium. Because the universe is very dense and hot and it's trying to make all these other elements, but it's expanding so fast in the early stages, there's no time to fuse other elements at all. So in fact, once the universe is a few minutes old, it stops fusing elements and it just consists of an expanding and cooling ball of hydrogen and helium. And so you cannot make molecules which do this cooling. And the reason, so I just said this, the reason I like this because it's really an interdisciplinary thing. The first stars which formed the universe entirely depending on this little pesky thing, hydrogen molecules. That's the most complicated thing you can make in the early universe in these first protogalactic clouds, H2 molecules. And they can radiate. They're not as efficient as carbon oxide or CO2 in our own galaxy, but they can radiate. But this, the way they radiate makes a very important thing for us here. They cannot radiate to low temperatures. So a hydrogen molecule is very simplistic. It only has very few ways to vibrate and shake. And you need to shake it hard to radiate. So once the temperature, it cannot take the temperature below 100 degrees Kelvin or so. After that, there's no excited states of the molecule. That's very different from Milky Way, where there's complicated molecules. A typical cloud in our Milky Way galaxy, where stars form, are a few Kelvin in temperature. So these clouds are hundreds of Kelvins in temperature. So I won't go into how the details of this, but this means that the first stars which form in these clouds, they're very different from normal stars. First of all, they're composed purely of hydrogen and helium. So that's kind of interesting. But more importantly, they're very massive. This very hot gas cannot fragment into small things like the sun. It's believed to only be able to fragment into 100 times bigger chunks, forming much more massive stars. That turns out to be very good for us. 100 solar mass star, again, this is all theory. We haven't seen one like this because we are 13 billion years later. And these stars, they're very short-lived. They live only for a few million years, so they're long gone. They popped up when the universe was a few hundred million years old. They lived for a few million years, and then they died, and they all leave behind a stellar, this black hole of roughly between 10 and 100 solar masses. So this is very good news when you want to make these big black holes, because these stars, we think they are there, they leave black holes, and they do it very early. in the history of the universe. So the way you should think of this, this is a picture I stole from somebody whose name is not visible. Sorry. This is just a simulation where you see the structure of the universe with clumps forming the... This is all the gas distributed in the universe. And these little cloudlets would make... would form in these knots. Okay, so let me skip this. So that's good. We're done our first job. We have a very small black hole very early. Now we want to grow it. So I want to explain now why it's difficult to grow the first option I presented, to simply feed it dinner. So, as I said, if you have the picture in mind, the gas falls toward the black hole and falls in, and is very bright. It converts its rest mass to radiation very efficiently, so it's very bright. Now, that's very good if you want to see them, but it's very bad if you want to feed stuff into them, because this radiation that's coming out, it actually limits the feeding rate. The radiation is photons. They're coming out of this black hole. And further out, the gas trying to fall in, but it's the photons impinge on this gas and don't allow it to fall in. So that's not good. That means the faster you try to feed the black hole, the brighter it is, and the more it radiates, and the more it tries to shut itself off. And so that's why I have this picture here. It's exactly like a baby. It has a theoretical maximum rate at which it can eat. If you feed it less rapidly, fine, it goes in. If you try to feed it above this rate, it doesn't go in, it comes out. Now that's just unfortunate, because we want to feed these black holes fast. And again, this is blocked out, but you can do this calculation. What you find out is you fall short by about some factor between 30 and 100. The largest black holes you can make by taking a single star, feeding it at this maximum rate, is maybe 30 times too small. 10 to the 8 solar masses. Okay, so but we did have the other option. So how to make the black holes faster, fatter, faster? So we augment this growth by mergers. Merge together many small black holes, which are all growing. And so here the issue is how you make two black holes actually emerge. Now, here again we have good news, because we think, we understand, not just theoretically, but in observational data, that galaxies, at least now, they merge a lot with each other. They collide and form bigger galaxies. That's how we think galaxies eventually are built up, from these little protogalactic clouds. They go about a million times bigger, from 10 to the 5 or a million solar masses to the Milky Way, which is about 10 to the 12 solar masses, through a sequence of mergers. So these are just pictures with the Hubble Space Telescope. These are two galaxies. This is a very old picture. You can see that they're actually colliding. This process, of course, takes hundreds of millions of years, or a billion years, so we can't actually see them merge. But we see them, we catch them in the act. So that's good, because we just said that there are these small black holes in the center of early versions of these galaxies, which are growing. And then these galaxies would merge. And so now we, in principle, have a solution to this. We grow the black holes by mergers and acquisitions, meaning they acquire a lot of mass individually, and then they keep merging, like big companies. And that's the proposed solution. So here, this idea sounds very nice. Again, we're in theory world, mostly. So one obvious question you should ask, well, can two black holes actually merge? They have to be obviously very close to one another in order to make a single black hole. I mean, you saw the picture that I said you all have in mind, probably, which is this, right? You have a black hole, it bends space-time. And I'm just saying there's maybe another one nearby. So they both bend space-time, and you can literally think of the analogy of the rubber sheet, the two black holes. They all make their, both make their funnel. But then, now we come to the subtitle of my talk, the black holes in orbit, because they, at some point, will be close enough to start orbiting one another. And that's very good for us, when once the black holes are in orbit, because they orbit each other, and they cannot do this forever. And If you don't live in some cave, you've probably heard the news earlier this year about gravitational waves. When two black holes do this, they orbit around one another, they distort space-time. In fact, it's really intuitively obvious. You get an A on the exam because you would say, well, this is clear. I have a bent space-time here and here, and I'm stirring things like this. I'm generating some kind of ripple and which can propagate. This is called a gravitational wave. And it's literally a very tightly wound spiral wave, which is a distortion in space-time itself, which is very, very dramatic near the black holes. And then as it propagates, it gets weaker and weaker, just like waves in water. And these waves carry energy. So besides the fact that we can see them, the good thing for us is that because they carry energy, that must come at the expense of the orbit of the black holes. So the black holes must slowly spiral inward. And after a certain amount of time, they must actually coalesce. Once they touch each other here, they must form a single black hole. And this is, I'm not involved in this experiment, but this is so exciting, I cannot give a talk anymore without showing at least one slide, that these waves were actually detected in February of this year by the LIGO experiment. So these are the ones, the detection that they made in February was of two small black holes, 30 Solomon-Haas black holes, which collided and generated these gravitational waves. And they were in a galaxy which is very nearby, because the sensitivity of this instrument doesn't allow you to see black holes very far. So in some neighboring galaxy, which we don't know where it is exactly, these waves were generated and they hit this detector, which is in Hanford, Washington, in the west coast of the US. It's a 4 kilometer long vacuum tunnel with two mirrors, and laser is bouncing between these mirrors. And what you see, what they measure, is the distance between these two mirrors, which are 4 kilometers apart. And if you can see this plot here, this is time, this is 0.1 seconds, and this shows you how the distance between the two mirrors would wobble as the gravitational wave goes by. In this case, this whole thing, because the waves spiral in, there are two things about this pattern that makes it very unique to detect. One is that the frequency increases. So again, that is completely obvious because the black holes are spiraling in, so they're speeding up. So that every revolution takes a little less time than the previous one. So it's speeding up. And the distortions, these ripples, get stronger and stronger as the black holes are stronger to one another. So that's why you see the wobbling of the mirrors gets more significant and faster. So now, this is just super exciting. I need to contain my excitement for a minute. But this is really, really not like other astronomy. When you see photons, you have an image. That's because the wavelength of the photon is tiny compared to the size of your source. Here, the wavelength of this gravitational wave is comparable, by definition, to the thing that's doing the emission. So this is much more like sound, where you hear a wave and you can kind of hear where it comes from based on just a single frequency that's hitting you. So I want to now get out of this presentation and show you what this sounds like. Because this really is a very, very good analogy. So this is called a chirp signal. So ignore these bottom panels. This is the thing I just showed. This is zooming in on the last few of these cycles before the merger. So can you play the sound? It's very dramatic. And again, the key here is called a chirp because its frequency is rising and getting louder. So I hope the artist after me can somehow incorporate this into the jazz music. Very good. So not only do we know this actually happens, we measured the parameters of these black holes, and we know they can drive the black holes together. Now, just to come back to our problem, in our case, we want to merge black holes which are much bigger. So LIGO, this experiment cannot see these, because these black holes, when there are million solar masses, they're much bigger. They can't go close to each other like small black holes, so the frequencies are much lower. The frequency here was 100 hertz, so that's just like sound, like a radio station. The frequency in the case of supermassive black holes is much lower, millihertz, but it does the same thing. It actually drives the two black holes close to coalesce and merge into a single black hole, and in principle, it could be detected as well. So this is just how you would detect them. This is something like LIGO, but this is here, our emerging black hole. This is the sun, this is the earth, this is the moon, and this is not exactly to scale, but it's basically three test masses flying around the sun with lasers shining between them in a triangle, and you measure the distance between these masses. They're currently debating whether this should be 2 or 5 million kilometers, the distance between these two masses, three masses. And this European Space Agency is going to launch this very soon. It's actually now 2030, so very soon. So that's very good. If this theory is correct, that the black holes are built up through accretion and mergers of themselves, we will be able to confirm this very soon with gravitational waves. But let me just come to the last part of this presentation. In order for this process to be efficient, you only have the age of the universe is, well, at that point, is less than 1 billion years. So you actually want this in spiral, due to the gravitational waves, not to last much longer, maybe 100 million years. Otherwise, it's too long. But that means these black holes already have to be very close. So we, in fact, I cheated. We can't solve this problem of merging two black holes, which were produced in the merger of two galaxies. The two galaxies merge, make a new galaxy. The two black holes are in the center, but they're way too far initially to make big enough gravitational waves to coalesce in less than 1 billion years. Now, luckily, we think we can solve this problem because, as I said 3-4 times already, these black holes in the nuclei of these wimpy early galaxies, they don't sit in vacuum, and you don't just have gravitational waves. There is stuff, gas, trying to now fall in from larger distances and fall onto these two black holes. But these two black holes act like a propeller and disturb this gas. So this looks similar to what I showed before. This is a computer simulation and not gravitational waves, but the distribution of gas flowing towards the two black holes, which are these two points. And this is very nice because, as you can see on this picture, this gas distribution becomes very lopsided, and it tugs and torques the two black holes and removes its angular momentum. So it's basically acting just like gravitational waves. It extracts the binary's angular momentum, and it can shrink over time. And this is much faster initially than gravitational waves. So we think we've solved this problem using the gas sitting in the galactic nuclei. Initially, it drives the black holes to about something like a light week or light month from one another, and then gravitational waves are strong enough to finish the job. And there's one more great thing about this theory, which is that, in principle, we can also try to confirm this. The gravitational waves are great, but we do have to wait till 2030, which is fine with me. But you can imagine that if a quasar, which I showed you before, is a single black hole just shining along steadily, this object that I'm showing here is not going to be steady. It's going to fluctuate in its brightness, because you can see from the movie, if you go back again, maybe one last time. So this material is distorted, which can cause the in spiral, but you can see that the black holes eat gas very intermittently. It's periodic. So that's a way to identify in a quasar where we can't actually see this pair of black holes, where that they are actually there. Just not one, but two black holes. So going back to this slide, can the two black holes really merge? We can check. Yes, we think so. Now, that's a nice theory, but how can we test this? And as I said, we cannot resolve the two black holes directly, but we can look for periodic variations of the light of a quasar. So that's something that happened over the last year. And I'm just showing you one example out of about now 100 such quasars, which we and another group at Caltech identified. So we have cataloged about 500,000 quasars. About 250,000 of them have good enough data that you can look for this periodic variability, meaning that people took observations of them over time. And this particular object, this here is days, this here is the brightness, and these are data points, and you can see that this is 10 years of data, and this fluctuates in brightness by about 15%. With a period of 5 years, this object is again not too far from us, maybe a few billion light years away, not at the edge of the universe, but it's a quasar, very bright, and its period is 5 years. So we think we have found a good proof that this process is actually happening. Gas which is fueling the black holes is periodically modulated. And this object would, in about 100,000 years, merge and produce a single black hole. So that's very nice. So I lived in the US now for quite a long time. I know you have to brag a bit. So this is when we wrote this paper, this was on the cover of the New York Times. And this here is the snapshot of New York Times about a year ago. And this here, if you go online, you can find out what are the most popular articles and the most email articles. And this particular snapshot of time, this was number 3, more evidence for coming black hole collision. That was an article about our paper. The reason I'm showing this is that number 6 here says overdose of Donald Trump at the GOP debate. So there was a period of probably about 24 hours in the history of humankind where people actually cared more about these merging black holes than politics. That was a very good 24 hours. I was told Donald Trump was not very happy. So I think that's a good place to stop. I just want to make sure everybody has the take-home messages. So I've told you large black holes are all over. They're seen in galactic nuclei nearby and also very far away. They can be very large and can grow from smaller stellar mass black holes. And in order to do this, I think we require both that the sufficient feeding of the black holes as well as mergers of the black holes. And this requires both gravitational waves and another process that pushes them to merge before gravitational waves can do it. And I think this is mostly, as I said, theory, but we're starting to confirm this. Hopefully there will be direct detections of the gravitational waves with this LISA satellite, and more proofs are coming from more traditional astronomical data for the earlier phase of the merger. So that's all I have to say. Thanks for listening.